I know some of you are really looking for your way, so that's what this group is about, this event is about tonight. So we have some really great panelists who have graciously given us some of their time. We have Carlos Serrano, he's New Jersey empanada guy. You may have seen his food trucks, you may have tasted his empanadas. I think the chicken ones are the best personally, but they're all very good. And he's really made a name for himself. And then we have Sandra Anderson Diaz, and she has, she's co-founder of her own cosmetics company that's truly unique. It's fashion forward, but it's also really health conscious. And she really cares a lot about women empowerment. And her story reflects that. And then we have Sarah Aubrey, and she's taken an alternative educational route. And she's done a lot of great things. Right now she's running her own business that's a grant writing and communication service for government agencies and private sector groups. So it's really impressive. And they're going to share their stories with us, which are very interesting. I've heard all their stories, and I think you'll be able to learn some information about how to find your own path. You know, figure out what are your passions. Some of you might already know that, but then also what path you take to make that passion something that is alive, real in the world, when you're serving the community and you're also personally fulfilled by it. So there's the path to finding your path, and then there's the path to making your path happen, and then there's a path that you're on. And so there's a lot of paths. So we'll have a Q&A afterwards. So we'll start with Carlos.
My path, how can I start here? 47, 48 years old, so I'm going to crunch 40 years of my life within the next amount of time. Life is full of unexpected events, you know, things happen, and I didn't wake up one day and said, the ultimate route to success is building an empanada business, and I'm just going to run around in a red Crocs and red bandana and sell empanadas out of my truck. That's the way life should be. And obviously, it wasn't. My path is very came with a lot of speed bump, a lot of bump, a lot of hardship, and I think we all have. We're all destined to deal with different challenges. We all put, like, you hear the phrase of we all put the ladder up against our own wall, different walls, and we all have different calling. And unfortunately, my calling was a little different and a little bit unorthodox and very. Abstract and disoriented and negative and you name it. So I was born and raised in Newark, New Jersey, and born to a single mom. Dad wasn't around because he was too busy doing what men did back in the 1960s, you know, which they still do. And you know, unfortunately, that, you know, I right off the bat, that's what I was dealt with. And no father, single mom, and eventually my mom had ways, she found every way to try to support me and to make money and to put food on the table, to the point where she sold her body, and she was a dancer and a stripper. And when you're a stripper, you make money dancing for men, you know, in nightclubs, and that's what my mom did. And you know, in the 60s, and I would say in the early 70s, things were a little different. It's not different than it is now, not that it's right or wrong, but my mom was a very hard woman. She left home at the age, I think, of 14, 15 years old. So she had to feed for herself, she had to make things happen, and so she was already tough by the time she had me at 20. So she, you know, no man will cross her that will try to hurt her, she will destroy him. And she was a very tough woman, very tough, and she still is. But And then you try to find a recipe for success. And I can tell you right off the bat from that moment, being a single parent, not me, but my mom taking care of me, and maybe seeing my father once in a while, was an amazing void in my life. And it kept on growing as I got older. But immediately, in a strange way, I don't know if it's a blessing or not, but she met another man, and he became my stepfather, who raised me. Now, he plays a big part in my life, in the 12 years of my life, because eventually he got murdered at 12. So my recipe for that, for success, is have my mom was a stripper, and my dad, my stepfather, was a drug dealer. He became a very successful drug dealer. He made very good money. That was what he did. And it's funny because right before he was murdered, he came, brought me into the room, and he told me, open that luggage, and you know, put a luggage on top of my mom's bed. And I opened it, I said, all right, what's the deal here? And he goes, open the other, because it's one of those old luggage that comes with another wrap on it. And then I opened it, it's like money, hundreds and hundreds of I don't know. There's a lot of money here. And she goes, I said, what's the deal with this? He goes, well, this is for you and your mom, so if something ever happens to me, you know. And I want you to know this is what I did. That was his moment of confession, to tell me that he was a drug dealer. I already knew. You know, when you're 12 years old, you pretty much know what your parents are doing, you know. And also, me coming in through the garage, noticing the van full of marijuana, that kind of, you know, gave it away. I can't even give it away. And it was funny because that van used to move every week. You know, every twice a week, he used to unload, download. It was always that smell, you know. And my mom used to say, no, it's a smell for the horse. We used to have a ranch. So it was, hey, I know the difference between the smell of the and marijuana. Yeah, so. It's funny, you guys are laughing because you guys know. You know? That I was. I know that. I know what you do. But he says, listen, man, it's not something that I advocate for you to do. I just hope that you someday don't be an idiot like me and fall into the trap, and this is what I do. This is all I know. And I want you to get an education. I want you someday to be a lawyer so you can bail me out. And that was his way of telling me, pursue something than what I do. I kind of got it. I already knew way before that I did not want to do that. Never touched it, never got involved, and never got involved in that type of business. And I just watched from a distance and learned what that world was about, and the violence and all the things that comes with that type of atmosphere. You know? So when I learned a lot, unfortunately, the bad stuff, that the easy way out is never the way out. And that's what in that environment does. Everybody wants to make quick money. Everybody wants to make a couple thousand. Listen, I'll teach you a way to make an extra $20,000 tonight. You know, and that's the way that world is. And people risk their life. I saw people today and they were gone the next day. You know, I saw dead bodies, I saw this, I saw murder. I saw a lot of things I shouldn't have seen. And people did crazy stuff for the sake of money. I think that was all my teaching to the grace of God trying to tell me and said, listen, man, this is your path. You're going to have to learn all the negative, but I got a better plan for you. And along the way, as I got older, I just decided to just watch and observe and learn from the environment that I was a part of. And then later on, somehow, I fell in love with playing baseball. I ended up being a pretty good athlete. And played collegiate, and I was offered to play minor league baseball too. And that was a great life, and that kept me off the streets. And it was my way of not dealing with reality. My mom has become, from the time I was 12 years old to the time I left home at 18, my mom was. She was a handful. She was, she's very abusive, emotionally, physically. You know, I grew up with that. I grew up with every type of abuse that you can think of. I had it, And I had to, after a while, you corner an animal, that animal would retaliate, and that was me. And my way of retaliating was just leaving the environment and go out to the baseball field. And somehow I found salvation there. People find salvation in different ways. Mine was the glove and a ball, and went out and played ball, and that was my thing. And I just happened to be pretty good at it, and it kept me in a very good, highly competitive level, and traveled the country and did that. And but when I would come home, I would have the chaos, the drama, the fighting, the violence, the abuse, and it's constant. And by the time I was like 18, 19, as soon as I graduated, I left. I left home. I went off to college and stayed out. And started pursuing life, like you guys do now. You go to college and do your thing. I did every job you can think of. And along the way, I had inside in my spirit to be an entrepreneur. I had this vision of creating. I wanted to create wealth. I wanted to create something and then make money off it and not end up in jail. That was my way of, okay, let me do this the right way. Pay taxes, make money, and not go to jail. I want to do things the right way. Took me years because I got involved. I went to college, and there's nothing wrong with college. I'm gonna tell you, I advocated for my kids. But there's things that I was exposed to that kind of crippled my vision to become an entrepreneur. I wasn't in the right environment. I was around people that were. And I think I was around people like that growing up also. People that were looking for a handout, not a hand up. And when you hang around with an entitlement people and people that are looking to get something for nothing, it rubs off and you become that. But I knew my spirit was telling me that is not the way life is. You need to learn to feed for yourself. You need to go out there and make things happen. My family were all dependent on social programs. They're all depending on government programs because they depended on other people. And so it was a cycle after cycle after cycle after my mom depended on government. So she could not feed for herself. So my cousins, all of my 12 cousins, somehow, some way, were depending on the government. And that was their way of, that was their solution to success. How much can they get away with? And I was already at a young age, I was like, no, that's not right. Why should I go to the corner store with food stamps to buy stuff for my mother, when yet she has a Cadillac in front of her house? And I said, okay, how did they get that money? How did they get that food stamp? Well, that's because they took it from somebody else that did something. And that's when I learned about entrepreneurship and said, no, I want to feed for myself, I want to fish for myself. I want to teach my kids someday to be independent. And then I got to college, and college was a little different. College was all about partying and women and baseball, and I did all that, and that was great. But I went to college for the wrong reason. I went for baseball and all that, and that was my own focus. But then I started focusing, I'm going in to get a job. Now, I'm not here to advocate that getting a job is bad. That's not my point here. My point is, I needed more than 9 to 5. I didn't want to trade hours for dollars. I wanted to make an impact economically. I wanted to create jobs. I wanted to make money. I didn't want to drive the same car the guy drives next door to me, or live in the same house the next guy to me. I wanted more. There's a difference between materialism and having a dream. Now that I have money and wealth, I'm still cheap. I don't go out and buy stuff. Now I'm still like, I could buy pretty much a lot of the things that I want now. But because of my habits, it kept me disciplined. But back then, I was in college, I was trying to get a job, I got a job. And that's what my intention was. You go to school to get a job. And then I met a beautiful woman along the way. I got married. And Gigi was, I messed her up, I really did, because she was so, she was the opposite of my personality. But we got married, we went the first 7 years with no kids, so we went into business for ourselves. We had some venture, but we had one thing in common is that we were entrepreneurs. And she was a blessing for me, but she also knew how to listen, which I wasn't good at, and I'm still not, I'm working on it. And but we had the same vision of entrepreneurship and pursuing something without, not a freebie. And she also comes from a very dysfunctional background. So we kind of related in a lot of ways about that. We got into some businesses, they did okay, and some of them not did okay. We struggled, and that happens, and we lost money. And but I always was hungry, always wanted a little bit more. And then I think that after 9/11, and there was a couple things that was happening, things were just not working out. I was 35 years old, I felt like I hit the peak. Both businesses that I was involved in went under. For the first time in my life, I think I felt depressed. I was home, I didn't move. I was just on the couch, But now I'm on the couch, but I'm not depressed, I'm just lazy. It's a big difference. It's a choice. But back then, at 35, I was like, this is not right, And I kind of lost my dream for the purpose of drive. You have your own business, and you gotta have a fire, to have, anybody can have a job, okay? Anybody can have a job. You get up, you show up, punch in, punch out, do your job, and go home. But you don't have to worry about the bills, you don't have to worry about the electric, the lights, the investment, all the other crapolas that come with that. So for us, I lost all that, and then one day I ended up bringing some leftover food. And in that food was some empanadas. And my boss had it, and that was the beginning of this strange business that I had no clue that I was gonna build. And in that conversation with my boss, he added empanada. Spanish turnover is the Spanish version of a pierogi. And he said to me, flat out, you should sell this in the white neighborhoods because I've never had this product. I said, great, but I'm not gonna make it. That's very difficult to make. I said, man, you gotta make this and sell it in a nice neighborhood. He was from Hillsdale, just to give you an idea. Okay, so you're not gonna find that type of food in Hillsdale. Okay. And I was, at the moment when we had that meeting, it was North Hamilton, another place that has nothing to do with Latin food. And the idea came out of this little room. And I said, oh yeah, that's a great idea, Gary. That's my boss's name. And we definitely, but I'm not going to do it. I said, it's very difficult to make these things, And I'm not going to go to my garage and sit there and make empanadas. Here I am with $500,000 house, and I'm all statused out, because I'm competing with the neighbor, Jones. And reality was that I was broke and I was in debt. I was so much in debt, And I had no upside to where I was at. I mean, it was bad. And then I don't know what happened. I'd be honest. I wish I could tell you something that's a wow factor that yes, one day I just became a banana guy and boom, I became this multimillionaire. No, it wasn't like that at all. I busted my ass. I did things that most people will not do. I would work at the airport. At the time, I was working for the United. Well, it's Continental, merged with United Airlines. I worked for the state, Human Services. By the way, I went to college for social work. That's a money maker. So listen, guys. Look, you want to help people, that's great, but you got to help yourself first, okay? And I learned about that, and I couldn't help nobody, And It was great. It got me a job that helped my spirit. I capped out at $45,000 a year, and that was it. That was it. That was a state job, and I had a little desk, an office, work 8 to 4, and I was gone. By 4:01, 4:02, I was in the car. That was my life. It was a routine. Monday through Friday, I had weekends off. And I said, and I was just, my spirit is, I want more than this. I know I can do more. I'm healthy. I can do more work. I can make changes. I can do something economically. And I had to get out of that work. But that job did gave me tremendous blessings. And we don't have the time to talk about what it did for me, but it did some amazing things for me. I walked out of that job from that conversation with Gary a year later and quit that job. 17 years. I had medical insurance. I had $45,000 coming in guaranteed, and I walked out of that job to make up a house. I was still working at the airport. Now, if you work at the airport, that's really tough. You got to load up aircrafts, and there's a lot of, 5,000 pounds. And it was a very physical, demanding job, worked overnight, left the wife and kids alone, and I had to go through that process. While I was doing that, I was building, making empanadas in my house. And that's how I started Empanada Guy. I cooked, I went out, did my research, bought raw materials, started cooking day in, day out. It was just one of those things. Jessica was already, I think, 5 years old. Jennifer was little. I used to carry her. I would make my presentations at restaurants to chefs. And they would see me walking in with two kids, and they were like, what are you doing with two kids? And this business meeting, I said, well, this is the way I roll, no problem. That's the way it is. You either take me or not. So you gotta have that. When you go after something, if you want something in life, you gotta stand your ground. You really got to look at people in the eye and say, you know what? This is who I am. Don't try to be something you're not. Yeah, I went there and I sat down with this six-figure, whatever, chef. And I told him, I said, we're going to cut a deal. And I got two kids sitting there eating chicken nuggets, and we're going to make this happen. And he's like, he's still a good friend of mine. But you got to go after it. And that moment in my life, and don't get me wrong, there was a lot of times I got in the car with my kids and I didn't cut those deals. They didn't work. I got beat up and they said no, they didn't like my product. It happened. So, but along the way, I kept on doing and doing. And then the moment came back in, in 2016 now. I would say 5 years ago. I was frustrated. The business, I was just selling to restaurants, so that I was just wholesale. And then I got introduced to this thing called Facebook, social media, 5-6 years ago. And my wife says, you should get involved. It'll help you promote your business. And then once I understood social media, I realized that it was a platform that's free, and you don't have to pay for it, and you can still touch millions of people. And that's how I started building a brand. And I built the brand. I knew the product was good, but I said the brand was going to overtake everything. It's going to get me through into different companies. And that's what happened. A lot of people started, I started communicating, do a lot of Facebook stuff. And one thing led to another. I had a lot of following. And I was creating a cult following in a strange way. And then the idea, I was going to get a restaurant, and that didn't go through, but in the back of my mind, the way to go was to get a food truck. And I just decided, let's get the food truck, let's do this thing. I put every dime that I had. Once we got the truck and arrived here, I brought it here from Florida, June 1st. Of 2012, I had $40 in my pocket, literally $40 in my pocket, because I had everything invested in the truck and in the food inventory. Remember, when you're selling, you have to invest so that you can sell. And we have to buy a lot of food and pray that it sells. And that's what we did. And that was June 1st, And I think we did over $1 million, almost $2 million in less than a year. It's ridiculous. Became a multimillionaire less than a year and a half. And I'm not afraid to say it. And I'm here to tell you, I'm a living witness. Living, breathing human being. I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer, but if you find something that you want to do, that you are willing to do what it takes, that this country will provide you the opportunity to do that. This is still the country that people swim to. People, you see what's going on. Everybody comes here. Why do they come here? I've yet to see somebody swim to Cuba. Seriously. Come here, why? We have this thing called free enterprise. And we, as Americans, don't take advantage of that. You know, we have to bring people from other countries to work here. You know, because they want it bad enough, and we don't. And I see people right now, I'm paying people on my payroll that were living in another country not so long ago, making more money than the average American that's born here. And it's not because of color and race. It's because it's what you want to do. It's because of how bad you want it. Work ethics. We've become a lazy country. We've become very entitlement is all over the place, and we got to change that. And it starts with the youth. And I will fight you to the death to teach you guys what work ethic is. You know, my girls will inherit my business, but they will not inherit my dollar, my success. Everything that they're going to get, they're going to earn it. They'll tell you right now. There's no. What do you call it? What do you get money every week? What do you call that?
Allowance.
Come on. Allowance. You gotta earn it. That's how you become a winner. You know. You get it. But we built the business through a food truck, and the reason for the success of the food truck, I don't know. I wish I could tell you, oh yeah, it's because it's red, or because I put my face on it, and it's red, and I drive around the country with it. I don't know. And if you were to visualize yourself with your picture on a truck, driving around selling a banana, and you'd be, yeah, you make a lot of money. Yeah, okay, sure. That's how I thought. And I didn't think, I just said, you know, let's just put the face there and we'll figure something out later. And but, you know, it wasn't strategized. I'm not that smart. I just stuck around long enough and did enough work to. So if you can get anything out of my story, it's, look, you're going to be dealt with. The Lord is going to put you in different. He's going to test you. Either you have faith or you don't. Let me tell you what, before you go underground, you will have some type of faith, because he will test you. You will get tested. And if you haven't been tested yet, you will be tested. It's just a matter of time. So we all become ashes eventually. This is all temporary. No matter how much money we make, how much success, how good looking you are, or how talented you are, how much money is in your bank, we all end up in dust. It's how much we can do while we're here, help each other out, create jobs. Now we have more than 40 people working for us. I have a plan of action of trying to create more jobs. That's what I'm in for now. And I want people to be part of what we're doing so they can also become entrepreneurs. I like people to get involved in my company and say, you know what, Carlos, I want a franchise. I want to be a part of ownership. I said, all right, let's do that. I like that, because once you become owner, you'll take care of the business better than you do than as an employee. Right? So, and that's my 2 cents. Hope it makes sense. Any questions? If you want any questions,
I'll ask you.
Some makeup, maybe?
Yeah.
Maybe we could do something. So
Jennifer and Jessica already know my story, so I'll try to mix it up for you this time so it's not boring. So my journey began when I was about 12. My father was a really good businessman and very financially savvy. And he had an office in our house, and he also had an office at his office. So he used to work at home a couple days a week, and I'd come home from school and I'd run up to his office to just talk to him for the day and see what's going on. And I would listen to him talk to his clients, and I was so fascinated. So I would just sit there and wait and wait and wait and listen to him talk about business. And I just knew at that point in time that business was something that was interesting to me and something I was passionate about. And he also was very financially savvy, so he would talk to me about the stock market and investing. And I was so hungry for it. My sister and my brother had no interest at all, but I just loved hearing more about his investing and his business. So at age 12, in my mind, I was like, I'm going to Wall Street. And I told everybody. And people were like, you're going to Wall Street? I'm like, yeah, I'm going to Wall Street. And I'm going to be on the board of directors of a big Fortune 500 company. I'm going to drive a Mercedes one day. And yeah, that's where I'm going. So very confident. And as my journey continued on after age 12, I found that I really had a creative side, and I loved art, and I loved music, and I loved creating clothes. So I developed a sense and a passion for fashion. So what happened was, when it was time for me to pick a major to go into college, my guidance counselor said, well, why not fashion merchandise? You get the fashion and you get the business. And I'm like, sold, done. So I entered the University of Delaware because they had a four-year program and a one-year program that would go to FIT in your senior year. So I thought, that's the best of both worlds, get a four-year college degree and go to FIT. Well, when I got there, I realized that the major was not exactly what I wanted. It was heavily geared towards becoming a buyer in, you know, a retail type of situation like a Bloomingdale's or Saks. And I realized that the one thing that was missing for me was the financial. I always loved the financial, so I pieced together in my mind that I needed to have more of a business degree with marketing and finance. So I switched majors in junior year, which I was told not to. It was the craziest time of my life, because when I went to go get some counseling on that, they said, don't do it. You're going to be going to school, you know, for the next 2 years nonstop. You're going to be overloaded with statistics and, you know, really hard finance classes, economics, all of that. And I remember leaving thinking to myself, wow, this stinks. What am I going to do? I don't want to be a buyer for a Saks. I really want to do something, you know, financial, but on the creative side. So I, all summer, I, you know, was thinking about it. And I went to my parents and I shared my frustrations and I said, you know what, I gotta go for it. And they supported me 100%. I applied into the business school, I got in, and I went to school fall, winter, spring, summer, fall, winter, spring. And by the time spring rolled around, because I had all the tough classes, I was toast. And I had two classes left, and my father, thank God, said to me, listen, you know what, you didn't have a senior year. I want you to go back in the fall, take your two classes, and enjoy your senior year. So I went back for those two classes, and unbeknownst to him, I got a job. I got a job as an assistant to a financial planner. And what was really kind of funny, speaking of drugs, my dad was, no, because my dad, he funneled my account, okay? And I was very good about, you know, only spending money on what I needed. He saw my account going up and he's like, we need to talk. He's like, okay, I don't know how to ask you this. Are you selling drugs? So I came clean. I'm like, no, Dad, sorry, I've got a job. And he's like, oh my, okay, what are you doing? And I told him, and I was so proud of myself, because for a big chunk of my childhood, my parents gave me pretty much everything. And I grew up not really appreciating the value of money until I went to school and I had to show up, I had to work hard, and it was all about me and the performance that I you know, did was all on me. And so it was when I went to college that I really understood how hard my parents were working on my behalf to send me to school. So I felt like it was time for me to give back a little bit, and hence the job. So I loved it. I was a sales assistant to a financial planner, and I would make phone calls, and I always knew that sales and marketing was really my forte. I loved, you know, dealing with people and always being challenged. So when it came time to graduate, the financial planner offered me a full-time job, and it was in Wilmington, Delaware. As much as I loved the position and wanted to stay with him, I said, buddy, I'm going to New York. That's where my heart is, that's where I'm going. So I knew that I wanted to go to New York, but also too, I was really unclear about what I wanted to do in the financial world. So what did I do? What I do best, I called everybody I knew. Called my friends, I asked them, hey, listen, do you know anybody who works in the financial industry? Would you hand out my resume? And ironically, one of my friends, her brother-in-law, rode the train with the human resources director at one of the companies and brought up my name. And so I got an interview, and I was so excited. Didn't even know what it was for. I was like, I'm going. Got the interview and got the job offer for, it was in compliance on the commodities exchange. The company was called Coffee, Sugar, and Cocoa Exchange. I didn't care what it was, I just wanted it. So I accepted it. Well, didn't realize that it was on a trading floor of about 5,000 men, and I was one of maybe 15, 20 women. So I was like, okay, I got this. Well, I get on that trading floor, and this was in the early 90s, so it was well before sexual harassment had really made its way in the limelight, and so it was more than a locker room. And because there weren't many women there, they didn't want us there. And so it was one of the most challenging times in my life because I was so confident in who I was. I'd always been surrounded by people who loved and adored me. I'd never been stabbed in the back in my life. And the minute I walked on that trading floor, it was like the lion's den. And people were out to see me fail, to push my buttons and really test me. Talk about tests. That was the first one. I've got many more.
Yeah.
But that was the first one. And I just remember walking on the trading floor after these guys had been taunting me for, you know, at least a month or two. And I had it. I broke down, and my dad used to drive me to the train every day because I lived at home. And he's like, how's work? I just started bawling. And I told him what was going on. And he said to me, which was very instrumental, he said, you know, you hold your head up high, you go there, and you do what you do best. Don't let these guys get the best of you. You belong there. Just you go do your job. And so he picked me up out of the car, put me on the train. And I remember going into work that day, feeling really beat up. I was emotional on the train, and I remember hearing my dad's words. So when I got into my office, I threw my shoulders back, and I was like, okay, I'm going on the trading floor. I took a deep breath, and I walked out there. I was like, and I said, okay, well, I am in compliance, so I had control. A lot of these guys, I had to ask for their trading cards and order tickets. They didn't want to really mess with me, so I showed them who was boss. And all of a sudden, things started to change. And that was one of the best learning experiences in my life because I was so naive and innocent, and I turned the tables around in my favor to really work hard and show them that I belong there, and that, you know, any woman can do a great job. And I actually lasted 5 years, and I developed some amazing friendships with, and they're all men, because there weren't many women there, but it was an incredible opportunity that really helped me for the rest of my career on Wall Street, because I spent my entire career on Wall Street. I still loved finance, I loved the marketing, and so I navigated from the trading floor environment to a marketing role in the futures and options industry. So that was really great. I got to do events, I traveled, I did road shows, teaching, investors and farmers about futures and options contracts, especially one in particular, a potato futures and options contract. So that was kind of interesting. When I showed up in Idaho with all of my cool, you know, suits and my, you know, necklaces and my purse, and the event was in a barn. So they looked at me and they're like, oh, no, 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 you need to go shopping. I came out, sweatshirt, sweatpants, sneakers. That's how I showed up to this event. So it was really kind of funny. But the marketing was a great addition to what I did in compliance. And then I always knew I wanted to be in sales. That was like a dream of mine. But the hard part was that I didn't have sales experience. So I decided that I was gonna once again call upon the people that I met. I mean, it was all about networking. I mean, I got my job in the marketing, I got it in the bathroom. I found my apartment from the bathroom, I found my job, because I talked to everybody. And so when it came time that I was really interested in going into a sales role, I called upon people, and one person that I had met, she worked in advertising sales, and she called me up and said, I have the perfect opportunity for you, I want you to come interview. And it was for an ad sales position for a financial magazine. And I thought, oh wow, this would be great. So I get to the interview, and the company had merged with a British-based company, and the CEO was interviewing me. The CEO from London, who managed 1,000 people, he was interviewing me, and I'm like, wait a second, how did that happen? I thought it was just gonna be like, just the person who runs the department, but it was the CEO. And he was one of the toughest people I'd ever met. He grilled me, and I went in thinking, oh, I got this. He grilled me and asked me questions on the fly, and just, I had to roll it off. And I remember sitting there thinking to myself, he chewed me up. I'm done. I just want to get out of here. And before the end of the meeting, he looked at me and said, you know what? I've never done this before. I've never given anybody offered a job on the spot, but you definitely have what it takes, and I'm going to give you a chance. And that was the beginning of my sales career. He believed in me. I mean, he saw that I believed in myself, and that's really what was so important, is that I believed in myself. I knew that I was going to be a valuable asset to whoever that would hire me, but he believed in me. And that was incredible, because that job allowed me to travel all over the world. I basically lived on a plane and was never around, but it opened up my eyes to how, you know, people live, different cultures and just different experiences that shaped me, you know, not only as a professional, but also as a person. And so I hit record-breaking sales, and, you know, within a six-week time that I got there, and I just kept hitting the ground running, and I got recruited from the parent company. They wanted me to come into a sales position for the top magazine, and so I took that as well, and just kept going, and I was doing phenomenal. I was making a ton of money, I was happy, I was traveling, and then a friend of mine reached out to me and said, listen, there's a branding firm, it's a privately owned branding firm that is in dire need of a salesperson. They've been around 35 years, and they're 6 months away from going under. And perfect for it. And I sat there thinking, you know, look, I'm doing great, I'm traveling, I have an expense account, I'm making great money, I'm having fun, I can't do that. And of course, I sat back, and I thought about it, and I thought about it, oh, and I had to take a massive pay cut. And I lived in Manhattan at the time, and, you know, I'm thinking, oh boy, I don't want to do that, you know? I got to drive the Mercedes one day. Well, turns out that I couldn't get that situation out of my mind, because once I met the owner of the company, his heart was so tied to his company. He was so passionate, like the way you were passionate about your business as well. And it affected me. It really hit me to the core, and I thought to myself, you know, I think I can do it. I think I can help this guy. And so it took me 2 months to really think it through. And I was walking away from my biggest commission check because in my contract, I wouldn't get my last commission check. And it was a lot. And I'd worked my buns off, flying all over the place to get it. And so I decided, you know what? I'm gonna walk away from the money. And I went to my boss and I told her that I was leaving. And she said, you know you're walking away from your biggest commission check, right? And I said, I know. I know. And I'm actually taking a pay cut. And I'm okay with it. And she said, you know what? I am actually going to give you that commission check because you earned it. And I remember thinking to myself, thank God, because I really needed it, you know? I really needed that commission check. So off I went and went to work. You know, I worked at this company, which was over 1,000 employees, down to like 8. And I knew that it was all on me, that I had to show up and I needed to deliver. And I also was taking on a position that would require me to go outside of my comfort zone. I knew there were things that I could bring to the table, but I needed to get into all facets of this business. And the owner was willing to let me do it. And I was young, I was in my early 20s, and he was like, I said, you just gotta trust me. Meanwhile, I'm thinking to myself, I don't even know if I trust myself on this, but okay. So I went in there and, you know, there were lots of different things from a business perspective, and I used my intuition in addition to the experience that I gained along the way, but I made some fast, hard changes really quickly. I started to develop strategic partnerships with people in the industry, and I hit the phones, I called on everybody that I knew, and I empowered the team. I got everybody on board to, you know, believe in what I was doing. I said, listen, I know there's gonna be a lot of changes, things that are gonna be outside of your comfort zone, but you gotta trust me. And we gotta work together as a team because we were only 5 or 6 people at that point in time. And so everybody signed up for that because they didn't wanna lose their jobs. And what ended up happening is about 1.5 years later, we turned a profit, and we were 6 months from closing our door, and we turned a profit and everyone got bonuses. And there was nothing more rewarding in my career than that. Making sure that, you know, what I was doing was actually saving jobs and giving people an opportunity to have a bonus and to feel good about what they did. And I always made sure that I verbally recognized people's efforts because I noticed in the career that I was in, you know, in ad sales, people were so quick to tell you what you're not doing, but not willing to tell you what you're good at, what you are accomplishing. And it was a really tough lesson to learn. I always thought to myself, if I'm ever in a position to have my own business or manage people, I'm gonna go out of my way to make them feel valued, to make them feel important every single day, because everybody brings something special to the table. And to me, it's not rocket science. You make people feel valued, what are they gonna do? They're gonna show up and they're gonna work their hardest for you. If you treat them with the respect and you know, the care that you would treat a loved one or a friend. So it was one of the best experiences along my journey, I have to be honest. And it, because it was in branding, it really helped me now with my own business. Before I started my own business, I departed, I worked in the syndicated leveraged loan market, which was one of the most complex financial instruments that I've ever worked in. And I did sales and marketing, and I hit, you know, record-breaking sales once again. Loved it. I had a great situation because I was only going into Manhattan 3 days a week. I had 1 day off, 1 day from home, and I was treated like a full-time employee. They were paying my gym. I had a big fat bonus, big salary. It was great until the day my son was born. My son was born on September the 9th, 2008. And he was the light of my life. And then 1 year in, all of a sudden, my son started to scratch and scratch, and he would end up bloody. And I'm looking, saying to my husband, what's going on here? We were clueless. So we took him to his pediatrician, and the pediatrician said, your son has eczema. I said, what's eczema? I have no idea what eczema is. Well, it's a skin condition that's, you know, ends up from dry skin, it can be brought on from allergies, food, whatever. So I said, okay, what do I do with this? Well, he said, why don't you take him to an allergist and let's test him for allergies. So we did, and you know, I had no clue what I was dealing with. And he got progressively worse and worse. And you know, the allergist was prescribing, you know, steroid creams, and they wanted to put him on medication, and nothing worked. And they told me that there is no cure for eczema. And I said, what do you mean there's no cure? And they said, no, we don't have a cure. And I said, oh, really? Well, I'll find one. You can count on that. And so I went on this mission, and I educated myself, and I went to seminars, and I talked to people, because that's what I do. And I learned everything I could about eczema, about any skin condition, and any disease, because I needed to find out how can I help my son. And we tried every single type of therapy you could think of, traditional, alternative, everything in between. I bought crocodile oil from a crocodile farmer in South Africa because somebody told me it would work. I said, okay. I did a test in the countryside of England because they didn't offer here. I mean, I was so dead set on helping my son because it pained me to see him every day wake up in blood, every day. And it got worse and worse and worse. He was covered. And so that job that I loved and I was at the pinnacle of my career ended up being, you know, a thorn in my side. I had a hole in my heart every day. I'd show up to my job. I had an office. I'd close my door and I would cry because it just tore my heart up to see my son, you know, in so much pain. And then I was leaving him with a nanny. It just, it was the most awful experience. So I came to that fork in the road and I decided that, you know, the career that I thought was going to take me, you know, wherever I wanted to go and drive that Mercedes was no longer important. It was important for me to make an exit and just be home with my son and figure out what I wanted to do. And I knew that I had to do something in honor of his journey because he had suffered so much. And I figured, you know, I have to do something that is positive and also something that would allow me to help other people in any way. And I was blessed to have, you know, different opportunities in business. I worked in all facets of business and I thought, you know what, I'm gonna do something. And I didn't know what it was, so I just sat with it, you know, after I left. And I ended up having a conversation with my now business partner. We were in my kitchen one day, and I had made so many changes in our life. I got rid of fragrances, dyes. We went all organic. I got rid of carpets in the house, put whole house water filtration system in. I mean, we cleaned the vents. We did everything. And my son started showing a little sign of improvement, so I knew I was on the right track. So I started to take care of my family, you know, with all the different changes, and the last person to go was me. Got to take care of myself. So when I was having this conversation with my business partner, Nadine, I said to her, listen, you know, I found an organic cosmetic line that I really love, but I haven't found a color cosmetic line. Everything out there is bamboo and white, and I'm a fashion girl. Like, I want my, you know, my black case with my weight in it. I want something that really reflects my own taste and style, and I didn't find it. I also wanted color palettes that were reflective of what was happening, you know, in the beauty and fashion industry. And the natural world just wasn't doing it. They were very disconnected, and they were kind of like in Whole Foods, and that's kind of it. So when we were talking, I asked her what she used, and she said, well, I haven't found one either. And her reasons were the same as mine. And I said, really? You know, ha ha ha, we should create something. And I laughed about it. And so she looked at me and said, you know, I think we should look into this. I think we should, you know, explore, because there's a huge gap between the natural, organic space and beauty and traditional. There's a big hole in the gaping middle, and there are going to be a lot more women like you and I out there, so why don't we explore it? And so that's what we did. We spent a year and a half behind the scenes doing all of our research, and thankfully we both come from strong business backgrounds, so we knew exactly what to do. And we launched our LLC, we trademarked our name, we trademarked our tagline, we hired consultants to help us with our content development, with our graphic design. We had hired a fashion photographer in New York, got a model from an agency, did a whole photo shoot, and we launched in the industry in August 2014. So we're now a little over 2.5 years old, and we are featured in brick and mortar stores throughout the United States. We also have a retailer in Australia and Canada that's online. We're on Amazon. We have our own e-commerce site, and we're cranking. And the best part about it is that, A, it's mine. So like you said, when you work for yourself, I mean, I have stayed up late night. I have worked on weekends. I have done everything you could possibly do to grow this business because it's got my heart stamp all over it. It's my son's inspiration. So it's not about making millions of dollars for me. It's about getting out there and empowering, you know, women to understand information about the choices they have so that they can make, you know, good choices for themselves and their family. You know, the journey of me educating myself about toxicity is still going on. My son is 8. I've been on this journey since he was a year, and I'm still educating myself. So every day I talk to all the customers who call in, and I have the pleasure of speaking to people and sharing and imparting that knowledge that I have learned, because there's so many more women that were experiencing sensitivities from the chemicals that are being put in makeup. It's really an interesting time for the natural organic world, because the more education that's out there, the more people are gravitating towards the natural organic space. So we have really seen a surge in people coming to us through our website, through the customer line, and I talk to everybody. And sometimes I'm on the phone for an hour because I can't shut them off. It's so important to me to make women feel empowered and feel good about themselves. And I've had people share like such personal stories about their journeys. And it's so healthy for me, because it just keeps me going on the days, especially where I feel like I just can't go anymore. And it's really empowering. So I love what I'm doing. And I think that the secret to behind anybody's success is your passion and your drive, and whatever you set your mind to, you can do it. You can absolutely do it. And it doesn't matter, you know, what your background is. I mean, you're like an incredible inspiration, you know? Seriously, you're an amazing inspiration. And I think that, you know, this country does give us a platform to do something that we truly care about and what we love. So I empower all of you to follow your dreams and go after it. And there's my daughter waving. Big smile. Thank you, guys.
First, I'd like to say thank you to my fellow panelists who have such amazing stories to share, and thank you to you guys for setting this up and inviting me. I feel really honored to be here. Like my fellow speakers, I'm also an entrepreneur, but unlike them, I did not have that passion to go into business for myself from a young age. What I did have a passion for was education, and that's what I want to talk to you guys about today. I actually did a self-directed homeschooling program when I was in high school, and so I thought that I'd use this time to talk a little bit about how I made the decisions that I made in order to pursue knowledge in a way that's non-traditional in terms of someone who might otherwise have had an academic career. So to do that, I actually wanted to ask you all a question first. Who here is interested in hard sciences? Anybody? A little bit? Okay, how about philosophy? Okay, cool. Well, great. So for those of you with an interest in philosophy in particular, are you familiar with the question of the difference between artificial intelligence and human beings? With that debate about, like, how can you tell the difference between robots and people, right? Does anyone in, like, a couple of words want to try and, like, give, like, a, nobody knows this answer, by the way. It's a philosophy question, so it's like nobody knows it. So, like, any guess is as good as any other. So in a few words, does anyone want to try to describe the difference between artificial intelligence and humans? Yeah.
I think I define life as a cybernetic system that uses the basic building blocks of life to fight against the law of thermodynamics that states that entropy will happen.
Okay.
That's what I was going to say.
Page 64 of Leviathan.
So the next panel is going to be on entropy, and you're going to does anyone else want to offer?
Oh, I was going to say free will.
Oh, there you go. See, I think these are actually really more similar than they might appear. But anybody else? Yes.
Heart.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. No, I love all these answers, and the reason why I'm bringing that up in this panel is because the way in which philosophers have attempted to answer that question has really informed the way in which I've tried to shape my own path there or my own career. So all these answers are things that are like legitimate, like philosophical propositions in order to try and answer that question, and you have people saying things like, well, there's a soul on the one hand and then matter on the other, or there's like phenomena and then physical matter, and there's all kinds of ways of answering it. But the one I'm most attracted to is the idea that regardless of what the answer is, right, we as human beings are in a position of asking that question, and artificial intelligence to date is not. And so in asking that question, we have the opportunity to think like, well, in what way do I want to ask it? Where are my values? What do I really care about? And I found from an early age that the strongest values that I had were of curiosity, compassion, and kindness. And so as someone who was initially going to go to PhD school to be a philosopher, I tried to approach thinking about things in that way. And I'm now going to tell you like a really condensed version of my school experiences and what led me to what I'm doing today, which is as an entrepreneur. I'm a writer, and I manage staff who write, and we do grant writing services and also plan like political events and do government consulting. And so, and all that seems unrelated, I promise it all is related, and I can explain that if anyone's interested. So when I was in high school, I was like really not into the traditional school system that I encountered. I was in Massachusetts. I was actually from a single mom family. We were on welfare as well. I was lucky enough to be in like a good like public school system, but it was still like we had some good teachers, some bad teachers. And when I was 14, they introduced standardized testing in Massachusetts. And I was upset about this because they were getting rid of some of my favorite classes that I was looking forward to in high school, and I ended up organizing my high school like fellow students in like a walkout against it. It was a really, really interesting time, and because of that, I was got interested in like what started high school in the first place. Like, how do we think this up? And in adult terms, it's like pedagogy and public education policy. Which, of course, I found that out over a course of learning about things. And one of the things I read was Grace Llewellyn's book, The Teenage Liberation Handbook, right? And that inspired a number of self-directed homeschooling centers, and there was one in Massachusetts. Like an hour and a half away from me, and I didn't have a driver's license yet. But kind of actually, in retrospect, conveniently, my family went through a period of homelessness at the time. And so I ended up having the opportunity, right, to leave high school. At the time, it felt like really difficult. But for me, it was something I was able to provide like this really nice solution to for myself. So I went and studied there, and whereas in high school I had these experiences of people telling me like this is what you need to do, show up, write another 5-paragraph essay, like score well on this test, and we're happy with you. At the unschooling center, I had mentors there, who some of you know, Ken Danford is one of them, right? Who asked me like, what do you care about? Like, what books do you think you should read in order to understand these questions that you have about American history, and like put those things together? And because I was asked those questions, I was able to answer them. And in answering them, I had the opportunity to think like, well, what do I really care about? And that's the connection right to the question that I asked you guys about what are human beings in at the end of the day. And so I thought that what I really cared about, again, like was politics, history, philosophy, all these things that seemed to be shaping the world around me. But I needed to learn Spanish if I was going to be able to understand the United States, because Latino culture is something that was like so important, and I had met a lot of people that were really influential in my life, especially when I went through that period of homelessness. And I didn't want to go to school to do that, so I went and worked day labor jobs, and I worked like in agriculture, seasonal work to save money and then go travel in Latin America. And I was able to learn Spanish without having to pay a degree to do it. But still, I wanted to be a philosopher, so I went to college. I moved back to the U.S., and I went to the Community College of Philadelphia, and then I ended up getting a scholarship to go to Bryn Mawr College, and I studied political philosophy there, thinking, again, I was going to go into a JD PhD program, and I was going to be just a philosopher, right? This was my goal.
And after college, I was able to win this scholarship. If anyone is interested in going to college, I say like, look at the ones that have good postgraduate scholarships available to do interesting stuff too, because not every college is eligible for some of the programs. But I went to this one called the Thomas J. Watson Fellowship, which gave me money to travel around the world for a year and pursue my own research project. So I delayed grad school for that, right? And then I came back thinking, well, I'm still going to go to grad school. But I had the opportunity actually to meet people in politics when I got back, and my sister, who was a bartender in New Jersey, she lives in Newark actually. she's super smart, and she had been in the music industry, right? And right when the music industry collapsed, she was a small business owner, she did music licensing. And she was like, she was picking up bartending shifts because her business was drying up so much. And she met people who were in civil engineering, who work with people in elected office. So she met people there, she ended up working in that job, so she knew a lot of elected officials. She was like, you study politics, why don't you meet these elected officials? And randomly, in just like a chat sit down, someone offered me a job to work as a legislative aide for the New Jersey Assembly. So I took that job, ended up as legislative director. And now deciding, right, like that, to be able to study philosophy and the things that I want to, it's actually much more dynamic and engaging for me to stay in the world that I'm in and carry this interest that I have for it. And so I saw an opportunity and I started this grant writing company, and most of my clients are municipal, like county entities, arts organizations and things like that. And it's been really awesome because I'm also able to write a book at the same time. So I'm writing something that I otherwise might have had to do in a doctoral program, which, I mean, it's still like a really good thing and maybe on the horizon in some way. But anyway, so I just, I want to say that, like, if we're thinking about what we're going to do, I think that start with thinking about, like, what it means to be human and what you really care about when you're asking those questions.
Awesome.
Knowing your values, knowing your heart, you know, and then listening to it is a big thing. And viewing struggles as tests rather than problems. Yeah. So, open up questions.
One of my questions was, one of the things that I saw was sort of that there are many, many chapters in your life. And it's never too late to start another chapter. But what I was curious about is, because a lot of you described it, like, at some points in life you're just grinding and going through the daily process and a routine to get to a bigger goal, and at some point you decide to leave that and try something else. So, like, in that decision-making process, when do you decide to start a new chapter?
When it hurts. When there's nothing else. Your threshold, we all have thresholds. We all can take pain to so much, you know. In her case, what changed her life, which a tragedy became a blessing for her, because, you know, I work from a spiritual standpoint, and in my translation to her, it's the Lord puts you in a position.
Absolutely.
He's like, you know what, you had a good,
yeah.
You worked, you earned it, but you know what, I'm gonna mess you up a little bit.
Yeah,
I'm gonna mess with what you love the most. And through your struggle, you know, he used your child, and your child was, your child blessed many people now. Because look how successful you are today, mm-hmm. because of that. Those challenges, and he put your world upside down, mm-hmm. and that's what took her to go mm-hmm. to build something else.
Right.
I mean, you totally walked away from this whole entire world, mm-hmm. and you went on faith, and you're like, this is my priority, my mm-hmm. child. And through there, he blessed you with, you know what, maybe you should get involved in this business. And I think we all have that. We all go through that. I never went for culinary. I took a culinary class in high school, and I got a D. That was my senior year, Oriana's class. I always talk about her. I visit her once in a while. But I never went to culinary school. And you know, what makes you do that? You know, change events in your life. You know, things are gonna happen to you. That's why, you know, you guys are young, and you're gonna go through some stuff, but your calling might be when you're 40 or 35, yeah, like me. You know, I don't control that. But along the way, try to do the right thing.
And I think you just have to be open to receive. Mm-hmm. Open to receive what comes your way, because you will be knocked down. You will be pushed so hard. And as long as you're open to receive that in a way that allows you to learn and grow from it, you know, because nobody wants to go through pain, but it's through pain that we evolve and we grow as individuals, and that's how we can empower people around us, by having these challenges. So when a challenge does come in your direction, if you can use it to learn and grow from it, I think that's what helps you along your path. And your path today will be maybe different from 2 years from now, from 5 years from now, like you said. I mean, it could be 40 that you find that connection, and all of a sudden something makes such good sense. But all the building blocks, like, I never thought when I was really young, I thought I was going to be at a Fortune 500 company, a senior managing director. That was the goal and the path I was on. And so, you know, if I didn't listen to the challenges that really rocked my world and pushed me, then I might still be doing that and showing up to work, collecting the paycheck, putting a smile on at the events with the people that stab me in the back. And that's not living, you know?
So can I give a response to? So your question, I think, as I understood it, was just about when you want to leave, like, a system that you're in. Like, you're in a system and you think that it's good, and then, like, when do you make that switch? Like,
yeah,
I'm going to completely step out of it. In my mind, I think that it takes, like, a pretty deep consideration of, like, what opportunities exist for you within that system. And in order to make that judgment call of, like, am I going to face this challenge, like, if I'm uncomfortable in the system that I'm in, and, like, weather it out and what I'm going to get to versus, like, what's available if I switch over, you know? And so I think that really involves, like, a lot of, like, logical analysis, and then also, like, check in with your heart and see, like, where you feel yourself, like, where you feel happy. So
yeah,
when you were talking about the sexual harassment, that's something that I also experienced in politics. Surprise. and so for me, like, I was thinking about, like, what kind of systems are going to be supportive of who I want to be as a person.
Yeah.
And I ended up having to create my own, and that's how I ended up starting my own business.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Good question. Along those lines, it's kind of goes along with his. So, yeah, I think everyone talked about, like, these pretty innocuous things that, like, conversations maybe you had with your boss about,
you should make something honest.
Or, like, you know, like,
maybe you should make some cosplay.
Right.
Like, that probably everybody in here has conversations like that often, right? So, like, why that? I mean, like, why that time? Why that conversation? Probably, like, lots of other conversations, like, man, we should do this. But, like, didn't pursue that. So, like, I'm like, why? Is there
I think
any
we
reason
all
I think about it?
We all go through that.
Yeah.
Every day, I think.
Yeah.
All of us have aha moment, you know.
Right.
How many ideas? We spend a lot of time knocking down ideas. I think I'm a victim of that. You know, we're all negative in our way, cynical,
right.
All that would never work. And I think if you try to do that less and be open-minded as much as you can, but I'm not also advocating to jump into every idea, because I know a lot of guys and girls that any idea that comes up, they jump on it and invest money, time, leave their kids behind, and it ends up being a mess.
Mm-hmm.
They tore their life upside down. And they invest all their time into this idea without researching.
Right.
And like you said just now about, you know, what is this going to do for you emotionally? And all you got to think about psychologically about what you're going to put your family through to do this new project. So
yeah.
I think we all get ideas all the time.
Oh, yeah. I have a notebook of ideas. You could borrow some of them. Never, you know what? I think timing is a really big factor. For me personally, when I came to that fork in the road and I looked at all the experience that I gained from a business perspective, and I thought, you know, I've been making companies a lot of money for a long time. I can start my own. Like, I felt empowered enough and so confident in myself that I could do it and align myself. The key is aligning, like in any business, it's aligning yourself with people who have similar philosophies about work ethic, about expertise. So in just the two of us launching our own business, you know, when we set out to bring on consultants, we interviewed tons and tons of people because we wanted to make sure that the people that we were going to align ourselves with were good people, kind people, and also who had very strong skill sets and expertise. And I think that is a key. If you are going to have a business where you are going to bring in other people, that you don't just, you know, go out there and hire people. So, you know, just anyone. But I think that's, for me, because again, coming from a business background and seeing all the different people that bring something to the table, I kind of knew at that moment, I know what I bring to the table, but I know that I can find the right people to align ourselves with.
Yeah, totally, having the right network in place too,
yeah,
right?
So absolutely.
And if you have an idea and you really love it and you want to pursue it, I think first think about all the people that you would need to rely on to make that happen, and then
yeah,
go and like try and make friends with them and try and see like what value you can offer them right now. So in my case, in politics and in government, politicians don't really like doing the work of government. They like contracting it out to other people. And with some contractors like civil engineers, where my sister works, do a great job, and others do less of a good job. And so it happened to be the case that there weren't a lot of people who had staff that could do writing really well. And I happened to have gone to a good school in the region and had a lot of friends who were recently graduating and needed jobs. And I'd done this fellowship, and their headquarters is in New York, and a lot of people moved to New York. So I had this network of people who were trying to pursue their own thing, and were like, yeah, but I could do writing on the side, right? So I was able to capitalize on that skill set and then match it with an opportunity. Yeah.
The other thing is, too, is that there's, I mean, even though I came from a business background, and we came up with our idea, I'd written business plans for lots of different companies, so I knew that was something I could do. But prior to doing that, I went to SCORE in Princeton, and I relayed the concept and the idea to someone outside of myself and my family and my friends and my comfort zone, because I wanted to hear an outsider's perspective on the concept and the idea from a business standpoint, to see if they thought it was a viable idea from their perspective. And that's a great organization that exists. There's many others. So that you can, like, let's say you have an idea, you can, you know, they're, you know, located in a lot of different areas, and you can just go, and they can give you lots of different advice and recommendations and resources.
I have another question. I was wondering if any of you guys had like a regular daily routine that kind of helped hold you together through all these different twists and turns and challenges and tests that you've encountered, and if any of those in particular really helped you continue along the path.
Well, I can start and say I meditate, and I love meditating. I'm actually like pretty sloppy at doing it at the right time of day or whatever, but I will at least one time a day sit down and do that. And so that's been a lifesaver for me, because knowing that I have a place to go to process things without asking myself to perform or like produce anything is really helpful.
I'm all over the place. I am all over the place because I have two kids. My husband works in New York. He stays in New York a couple days a week, so it's on me. So I have to manage the business, I have to manage the kids, I have to manage the house, and you know, when the hot water heater blows, like, you know, it's all on me. So in terms of having anything specific, the one thing that it's more a philosophical thing is that I always, always believe in myself. I stay positive. I look at the positive in everything. I don't get emotional about business. We've had a lot of, you know, stumbling blocks. When we're waiting 3 months on lipstick cases from China and they came damaged, and it's gonna take another, you know, 3 months to get them, I don't get emotional. It's, you know, you gotta stay focused and remove the emotion. I think that's really important when you're an entrepreneur, because it's easy to get caught up, especially, you know, from my perspective, if I'm pitching, you know, a very prominent store that I want to do business with, and I can tell on the other end that they're giving me, you know, objections and they're really not interested, for me to stay focused, to not get emotional and keep my eye on the ball, always have a goal in mind, no matter what it is, whether it's, you know, landing an account or it's, you know, selling your ideas, always just have a goal in mind when you go in, and also understanding what objections might come your way. I think that's huge, whether, you know, again, selling an idea or selling, you know, in my case, products. I always know before I get on the phone when I call somebody what the objections are going to be and what my answer is going to be, because once they come in my path, then it's a process. Everything is a process, and so it's very helpful to know what your end goal is, and it might not even be, you know, actually landing a client. It may be, I just want to open up a dialogue, introduce myself, and I want to have some positive reception on the end of that call, because a lot of times it is a process, but I think that's super helpful.
Well, I go, the meditating thing, my kids and my wife just got me into it.
Oh, cool.
I'm just trying to stay awake.
Yeah. There's many times when I fall asleep.
It's like, well, before we went there last week, and it was my first time, and all I kept on hearing is, Dad, don't fall asleep. If I hear you snoring in the back, you're going to embarrass me. And because they know how stressed out we are, day in and day out, like she says. My wife is the CEO of this company. That poor woman, I put her through hell. She's doing so many things, and then picking up the kids, dealing with their homework, and a mother's job is never ending, and it's tough. And you know, I built the business to a certain level, but Gigi is, you know, I think when you ask that question, then what do? I'm very lucky, very fortunate.
Attention, please. The time is now 8:30. The library will be closing in 1/2 hour.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
There's my call.
Attendance before the hour. So please remember to save your work.
Okay.
If you're in need to make a phone call for a ride.
Oh, he's gone. We've been here.
Can I finish my point now?
He's traveling.
It's so funny. She said, "That includes you, Carlos."
She'll be back in a few minutes.
But pretty much, you know, finding, you know, what do you do to prepare yourself? And yes, that's a great thing, and I'm all for that, and I'm working on that. And but you gotta have a goal. You gotta wake up every day like you're in the jungle, and it's you. You're either gonna be the lion, or you're gonna be the what's that little animal that runs around and gets eaten all the time? That one. Yeah, exactly. That's how life is. You either eat or you get eaten.
Yeah.
And I ain't gonna get eaten. You know?
Yeah.
And that's just how that works. But I'm very blessed and lucky to have my wife. To okay, Carlos, this is what you're doing today.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm all over the place. I totally hear you, and yeah. I wish I had the way she thinks. She's processing.
Me I too. Tell. I can more than that.
I can tell.
There's actually like a method of thinking about your goals that I do have a process.
You're my wife. Yeah, I tell you, and that I don't have that, and I so thirst that. You know, I want that, but I'm all over the place, and thank God.
You have a consulting gig right there.
Oh, yeah. There you go, right?
Yeah. It's just amazing. Thank God that she's around to help me live like that. But that helps. Yeah. You, my opinion, my think like that. Be structured as much as you can.
Yeah.
But also, when it's time to rock, when you're dealing with another human being, you're going to cut a deal, show your heart.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Show your heart. So don't be plastic. Don't be so anal and so, you know, just talk from the heart when you're going to cut a deal.
Yeah.
Sometimes the emotional deals are the best ones you make.
My favorite one for a process is, I forget the acronym, but you think about what it is you want to do in each category of your life. So I'll be like, this like client that I'm working with, here's my goal. And then I write it down in like actionable items that are like time constrained.
Oh my gosh.
And then after you
make sure I didn't say why it's important, like how that fits like my larger values, which it tends to be like repetitive with a lot of the daily activity stuff. But it really helps when you sit down and you write like, oh, the reason why I'm doing this is because I really want to keep this client because I really want to continue to grow my business, and but because of this like other reason that my business is important to me. And it seems kind of silly, but when you do it, it really helps you stick to your goals because you just have that space to remind yourself. Mm. You can look that up like online, like there's like.
So. Oh, I've heard all of you say that you've worked really, really hard. You work your hearts out building these businesses, for example. Is there some kind of light at the end of the tunnel in terms of greater balance in your life that you find that you're able to sink into eventually? I ask that from a place of being a kind of that very regimented job as a public high school teacher. I'd really love to do something different, something that I have more discretion over my time, something that makes a difference, something that my young children can see me doing something real. I really want it, and I'm willing to work hard and hustle. And at the same time, I want to be sure I have some time for them and me and life balance. And I don't want to just ultimately be running myself ragged for a long time. I wonder if you might be able to speak to that from your experiences.
Dive in. If you want it bad enough, there's no structure. This is. You can't serve two masters. You when you're gonna go out and pursue something, if you want it bad enough, understand that there's gonna be a process of there's no vacation. We just started vacation a year and a half ago, and we've been doing it really good. We go on boat cruise like within every 6-7 months. We're doing stuff. Now we're starting, you know. I mean now we're doing things, but before we didn't do that because I was too busy. There's a sacrifice, and you got kids, and you want to be a winner in front of them. You want to show them something, you want to see something, you want to leave something behind. And unfortunately, there's a price to be paid. I don't know what that price is, you know? And there's no balance, man, because it depends on how big that reward is. And she knows, she'll tell you, you know, you're going to go after something. It, don't hokey pokey your dream. Don't just go down and in, Don't play around. Don't waste your time. You either got a dream or you have a fantasy. Okay? It's a big difference. You're gonna have to dream of something you go and die for. You cry, you stay out, you drive, you sleep in your car like I did for years. Alright? And you do that to pursue that dream, that goal. Fantasy, man, you can get a bunch of those. So I don't know. That's up to you.
There's a price to be paid for the status quo too. So
Yeah, there is a price because being stagnant and 9-to-5 paying the bills and just getting by wasn't for me.
Yeah.
Because that's average, man. That's average. Shoot me. I'm done. I don't want to do that. I can't teach that to them. I want them to know that there's more to life. That you I want to max out. You only have X amount of time here to make an impact on this world.
You know, what's interesting about what you're saying is that, because I was going to New York, and I would leave, you know, the kids would get up and the nanny would be there, and she was the one feeding them, getting their stuff off to work.
You had a subject there.
Yeah, and then I would come home late, so she was there, you know, all day, and so they would only get me for this much time. Well, now I'm the one getting up in the morning. I'm the one there after school, even though I can't really spend quality time with them. They know I'm there. And like my daughter was home on Monday, and she had a cold, and she really didn't feel good. So I let her sleep for a little bit, and then I put her to work, and she started putting labels on things for me, and we did it together. So there's ways to. I guess depending on what you do to try to, it's so important to me to incorporate my kids into what I'm doing. Inviting them into my world, even though like my son's like, yeah, whatever. Even my daughter, she's not really into it until I took her to Fashion Week, and then all of a sudden there she was in front of the red carpet, like, woohoo, you know? And she found that to be really fun because, you know, we do a lot of fashion shows. So, you know, if you just keep your eye on the prize, like Carlos is saying, and you stay focused, laser focused, your kids somehow, they'll be incorporated and you'll find that you'll have more quality, it's not quantity, it's more quality time.
Everything we do business-wise, and I know you've done this, you bring the kids with you. Make them a part of your madness.
Yeah.
You know, they ran the food truck for us. They literally ran.
Yeah.
They, you know, Jessica and Jennifer and Jelly, at the time she was 2.5 years old, she was at the window. And we built the business that way.
Yeah.
You know, because that's the way it is.
Yeah.
Make them a part of it.
So how did you, I heard some of your story, but how did you sort of find the niche? Like, you know, there's a lot of things you can do, and you're saying you get a lot of ideas. So how did you sort of decide on, okay, this is what I want to pursue? I know I heard a little bit from you, someone friend said, okay, let's just do this, but you know, you had the discussion with your boss that, okay, let me, from the interview you told me it took a year, how did you decide on that?
Well,
and also, how did you decide to start your own business as well, on the grant writing?
Yeah.
One, it was just, I did some process thinking, like she said. Yeah, I have that moment in my life once in a while. But when the idea makes sense, I took, I spent a solid month, I would say, and researching the flour, meat, and stuff like that. And then said, okay, I'm going to cook out of my house. There's a process, when you cook. And my dream, my goal was to make 300, 400 empanadas a month. That's it. That was my goal. That's it. And I figured out how much to buy, what to cook, how much temperature, without no guidance whatsoever. I became...
The idea to start with you.
Yeah, I became infatuated. I became compulsive. When the dream takes over, the facts don't count. I just became obsessed and compulsive. And that's the only way you're going to be successful. I don't care what you do in life.
So my first grant writing client was a city in New Jersey that I was friendly with the mayor, and he knew me as like a policy thinker and a good writer in my position in the legislature. And so he was like, I'm having a lot of trouble finding a good grant writer, and I was wondering if you would maybe even consider like recommending someone to come in full time for us, or maybe you could like even do it part time. And I was like, well, what if I do it as a contractor and just do it on the side? I like writing, I know how to write grants, so it was easy enough to add on to what I was already doing. And I ended up actually working at the College of New Jersey here in Ewing, the neighborhood, right? After the job for the legislature in their civic engagement office. And I don't know if anyone here knew my boss who tragically passed away, but Pat Donahue, and I was working directly with him. And without him, the department was going in a different direction, and wouldn't be the place where I'd be able to pursue teaching public policy in the way that I wanted to. And also gave me the experience working in higher ed with all of my colleagues who are professors there and realizing what the market is like for professors. And then really, like, if you can find one job, it doesn't matter what the institution looks like or where it is in the United States, you have to take it because there's not a lot of, like, demand for philosophy professors in the world. But anyway, so I had opened up this LLC to take on this one client part-time, and then had this situation happen with my full-time gig at TCNJ, and I just decided that that time was right. And the way you get business in the public sector is cities or any other public entity issues an RFQ or an RFP saying, like, do you want to work for us? Send us a proposal. So I just started sending out proposals on my own, and it just kind of snowballed. And I was able to move that from my full-time gig to actually providing employment for others as well. And so it wasn't like me thinking, hey, I can't wait to start a grant writing company, right? But it was rather just like this opportunity. And the reason why I was framing my choices in terms of my way of like thinking about like what the value of life is and how I can best like engage in my own morals and behave like as an ethical person in the way that I want to. For me, it really is just like answering like an opportunity that is presented to you and thinking like, how can I build this out and best reflect like who I want to be, in the world? Like, so Carlos was talking, like, you didn't like wake up and like every day in like the sixth grade and think, I can't wait until I'm an empanada salad, it just happens. But really ultimately, like what you're doing, like it's awesome to have a product you believe in, but what you're doing in business is business. It's like, it's a matter of if it's empanadas or
you're
up to a certain degree.
Yeah. There is one thing that I want to share is that when I was in my early 20s, I opened up my own brokerage account. And that was because my father, once again, taught me about the markets and about investing. And it was something I did because, again, I had that knowledge. Well, when I had that conversation in my kitchen that day, what really enabled me to say, let's go for it, is that brokerage account. That brokerage account that I had funneled my entire career, and I started out in the financial world making nothing, absolutely nothing. But you know what? Even though I was making a small amount of money when I started out, I saved. I put it in the 401k, I put it in the pension plan, and I put it in my brokerage account. So if you have an idea that you want to maybe pursue, whether it's now, start putting money away now. Because that's what gives you freedom too. I didn't have to go out to investors. Thankfully my business partner and I had enough funds that we could pull together. And for me, it was my brokerage account.
Mm-hmm. So.